Hachette Audio presents the Gentle Parenting Book, How to Raise Calmer, Happier Children from Birth to Seven, written and read by Sarah Ockwell-Smith. A note on this new edition. When I wrote the first edition of this book, back in 2015, gentle parenting was very much a fringe movement. Most people had never heard the term before, and explaining it over and over again felt like wading through treacle. Never in my wildest dreams did I imagine how popular the idea would become. 7 years and over 50,000 UK sales of this book later, the ideas contained in it have featured online in articles on Oprah, have been discussed on primetime Fox News in the USA, national BBC radio stations, Good Morning Britain, Hollywood podcasts, and in almost every newspaper and online news source in the UK. It is even rumoured that the Prince and Princess of Wales practice gentle parenting. Over the last 2 years, Google searches for gentle parenting have quadrupled, and the gentle parenting hashtag on TikTok has had almost 3 billion views. Wow. Given this surge of interest, I felt it was time to revise this book, to bring it right up to the present and answer some common questions I have been asked about gentle parenting in the years since I wrote the original. In this edition, you'll find a brand new chapter on how to become a gentle parent and why who we are is so much more important than what we say. I've also added a chapter covering some of the common myths, criticisms, misinformation and confusion I come across concerning gentle parenting. I hope it helps, and who knows, maybe in another 7 years, gentle parenting may be the mainstream way of parenting. And what an amazing idea that is. Introduction. What is gentle parenting? Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. Margaret Mead, cultural anthropologist. Tiger parenting, French parenting, helicopter parenting, free-range parenting. The 21st century has seen a tremendous surge in new trends of parenting styles. How, you might ask, is there room for another one? And therein lies the beauty of gentle parenting. Gentle parenting isn't a trend, it isn't a label for a precise way of doing things according to one person's point of view. While many have attributed the parenting style to me, it is in fact a grassroots movement. People have been parenting this way before I was even born. I just gave it a name. Gentle parenting is an ethos, a way of being, you might say. It is mindful of current science and child psychology, while remaining respectful of cultural and historical practices of child-rearing. It is a holistic philosophy that considers the emotional as well as the practical aspects of parenthood. In a nutshell, gentle parenting is a lifestyle that encompasses both your physical and psychological behaviour, not only towards your children, but to yourself too. Because parenting should be a dance between the needs of children and parents. And with practice, this dance can lead to something quite beautiful and tremendous growth for both. Gentle parents come from all walks of life and make all sorts of choices. Some decide to birth naturally at home, some elect for a cesarean section. Some carry their babies in slings, some use prams. Some breastfeed, some formula feed. Some stay at home, some return to work. Some homeschool their children, and some take a mainstream educational route. They all have one thing in common, though. Their choices are all informed, educated, and made out of respect and empathy for their children, as well as themselves. This is gentle parenting. Nothing more, nothing less. For too long, parenting has been viewed as a battleground. Some parenting methods give all control to the parents, for fear that children will become unmanageable monsters as they grow. Others give children far too much control, with parents scared to discipline when necessary for fear of upsetting their delicate offspring. Gentle parenting is all about finding a balance, giving children just enough control at a time when they can handle it, while putting appropriate boundaries and limits in place. It is about being ever mindful of the long-term effects of your actions, as well as your child's safety and the expectations of society. When it comes to societal expectations, gentle parents understand that many of the beliefs that society holds about the behaviour of children at any age are unrealistic, and that a number of today's parenting practices are not only at odds with the needs of children in the present moment, but may also inhibit their development in the future. Gentle parents are not afraid to question received wisdom, no matter who it is coming from, or to be advocates for their children, even when their behaviour is frowned upon by the mainstream. Gentle parents have a close connection to their children. This allows them to feel safe, respected, and valued. In turn, this nurturing environment helps children become confident, free-thinking adults. What if everyone embraced the notion of gentle parenting? Would it change the world? I think it might just. Gentle parents are not perfect. Gentle parenting is not about being perfect. All parents make mistakes. The key is learning from them, understanding what happened, why it happened, and how we can be and do better next time. From this perspective, making mistakes as a parent is not only understandable, but crucial. For it is only when we don't quite do our best that we can learn to do better in the future. Gentle parenting, therefore, is about accepting our imperfect selves, forgiving our mistakes, and striving to grow as parents. As much as our children are learning, so are we. We all have bad days, days when we shout, days that make us feel ashamed. But gentle parenting is about being real, recognising when we are stressed and in need of some me time in order to be a better parent. In fact, this is so important I have dedicated a whole chapter to it. Gentle parenting requires nothing more than love, dedication and consistency. It isn't reserved for the most naturally calm or highly educated parents, for stay-at-home parents or for those with only one child. Money, qualifications and temperament are not relevant, and it doesn't matter how you are parented yourself or if you started your own parenting journey using a different approach. Chapter 8 is devoted to those parents who previously adopted another, perhaps less gentle method and are now looking for another way. You will also find a section dedicated to coping with criticism of your parenting and what to expect in terms of results, when you might start to see them, and what to do if gentle parenting doesn't seem to be working for you. Why does gentle parenting matter? We live in a world that places more value on things than on people. It is all about the acquisition of stuff and the pursuit of more. We spend so much time dwelling on the past and planning for the future that we forget to live today, often missing the things that really matter. Our society is selfish, violent, short-sighted, valuing conformity over respect for individuality. And this is the world we are preparing our children for. But do we really need to raise them to buy into this ideology? What matters more, happiness or fitting in? Can we raise children who respect their own thoughts and bodies, rather than lay the foundations for body image and confidence issues? Can we raise a generation who care about the environment rather than view everything as quick, easy, and disposable? Ironically, in our quest to bring up children to fit with society's goals, we often bypass what is really best for them. How will anything change in our world if we don't question commonly held beliefs and encourage our children to do the same? Gentle parenting is so much more than what you do with your children at any given moment in time. Raising our children gently builds a better future for us all. Gentle parenting is about creating a future where happiness is not dependent on the house you live in, the car you drive, or the labels in your clothes. It is about a future where violence is dramatically reduced and where differing opinions and beliefs are not only respected but valued. And a future where discipline does not involve inflicting physical harm and pain, exclusion, shame and guilt on some of the most vulnerable members of society. Popular childcare advice over the past century. In order to make sense of our own upbringing and the prevalent opinions of society today, I think it is important to understand how mainstream childcare advice has developed over the last century. At the beginning of the 20th century, the focus was on high demand, low responsivity, and a great degree of parental control, a style which can be summed up as authoritarian. In 1913, Sir Frederick Treby King, a physician who founded New Zealand's Plunkett Society, a service providing a range of health services for babies and children, published his childcare book, Feeding and Care of Baby. Credited with dramatically improving the nutrition of children in New Zealand, Treby King is perhaps better known for his authoritarian discipline and ethos of detachment. He advocated a regimented schedule that included feeding only every 4 hours during the day and not at all at night. Babies, he said, should sleep in their own room from birth, should be left outside to nap in their pram during the day, and should not be cuddled for more than 10 minutes per day. This, he believed, allowed the baby to place all of his or her energy into growing and developing without being hindered by too much bonding with parents. Treby King said that boys should be toughened up and readied for entering the military when at school, while girls should be trained to be mothers and homemakers. In 1928, American psychologist John B. Watson published his book Psychological Care of Infant and Child. He viewed children, in a sense, as made and not born. He believed love was conditioned in babies by touching and stroking their skin, and with this in mind, warned mothers in particular to not over-coddle their children, lest they grow into adults who would permanently need coddling and have difficulty forming relationships if their attachment to their mother was too strong. Watson summarised this idea thus: never hug and kiss them, never let them sit in your lap. If you must, kiss them once on the forehead when they say goodnight. Shake hands with them in the morning. Give them a pat on the head if they have made an extraordinarily good job of a difficult task. Watson also emphasised the importance of a formal, strict daily routine encompassing all areas of the child's life, including eating and drinking, toileting, sleeping and playtime. Although Watson is well known for his harsh and potentially damaging recommendations, his advice was not all bad. He was in favour of children being brought up in a calm, non-violent environment and encouraged parents to promote their independence, keeping them well occupied and engaged in order to reduce the onset of tantrums. In 1946, American paediatrician Dr. Benjamin Spock published his book, The Common Sense Book of Baby and Childcare. Spock is well known for bringing more affection and emotion to parenting, and his groundbreaking views differed significantly from the mainstream approach to parenting at the time. Spock is famous for telling mothers around the world that you know more than you think you do, encouraging them to listen to and trust themselves and their babies. He advocated a more flexible, individualised, baby-led routine when almost all experts recommended parents practice strict control. At the time, Spock was heavily criticised for promoting permissive parenting and instant gratification for babies and children. Despite the book selling over 50 million copies, these criticisms remained for over 50 years until Spock's death in 1998. In the 1950s and 1960s, British paediatrician and psychoanalyst Donald Winnicott developed his concepts of holding and the good enough mother, which apply just as much today. Winnicott described a mother's physical and psychological holding of her child as providing the confidence and support necessary for the child to grow and develop into a healthy individual. He believed that the foundations of health are laid down by the ordinary mother in her ordinary loving care of her own baby, and was also a proponent of increased empathy and trust in mothers. His idea of the good enough mother highlighted the fact that the mother's small mistakes actually facilitated the development of her child. He held that no mother was perfect, and indeed that perfection as a mother was actually undesirable. It is when a mother trusts her judgment that she is at her best. In 1951, the work of British psychologist John Bowlby was published by the World Health Organization under the title Maternal Care and Mental Health. His thinking was largely based on his observations of hospitalized children separated from their parents and on the work of René Spitz, who studied the effects of children orphaned or separated from their parents during and after the Second World War. In contrast to Watson and Treby King, Bowlby believed that love and affection are vital for a child to thrive. His theories advocated high responsivity. He is famously known for saying, "The infant and young child should experience a warm, intimate, and continuous relationship with his mother, or permanent mother substitute, in which both find satisfaction and enjoyment, and that not to do so may have significant and irreversible mental health consequences." Alongside his colleague, Mary Ainsworth, Bowlby later developed his theories into a concept known as attachment theory, elements of which have been used to formulate a style of parenting known as attachment parenting. In 1977, British psychologist Penelope Leach's best-selling book, Your Baby and Child, was published and has since sold over 2 million copies. Her focus was on empathy, trust, and connection, promoting an authoritative parenting style high in parental responsibility. Leach strongly advocated a child-led style of parenting, as opposed to parent-imposed routines. Then, in 1985, American pediatrician Dr. Richard Ferber brought the idea of cry-it-out sleep training to the fore, a concept first put forward almost 100 years earlier by the American pediatrician Dr. L. Emmett Holt. Although Ferber examined several approaches to tackling problematic infant sleep, he is perhaps best known for what is commonly referred to as Ferberization. The process of leaving a child to cry for increasing lengths of time in order that they learn to not cry out at night and sleep through without parental assistance. This approach can be seen as highly demanding of children and requiring little in the way of responsivity from parents, a classic example of the authoritarian approach to parenting. In 1999, the best-selling book, The Contented Little Baby, by maternity nurse Gina Ford, marked a firm return to this more authoritarian, parent-centric style. Ford encouraged a parent-imposed routine covering almost all aspects of the baby's day, including the time to eat, sleep, and play. She also recommended sleep training for babies. This theme continued into the noughties, with Nanny Jo Frost, perhaps better known as Super Nanny, introducing millions of families to a strict, no-nonsense style of authoritarian parenting through her books and television programmes. Frost has become widely known for her use of the naughty step as a tool for controlling unwanted behaviour. So, in little over 100 years, we seem to have come full circle, despite much scientific research indicating that the responsive authoritative, not authoritarian, parenting style is the most healthy and effective. With this in mind, it is important to remember that the prevailing messages when our parents and grandparents were raised were likely authoritarian in nature. Simply put, they probably thought that their parents were doing the best by raising them in this style and thought that this was the best way to raise you too. They may then, perhaps, wonder why you do not choose it for your own children. What gentle parenting isn't. Let's get this out there right now. Gentle parenting is not permissive parenting. Among those who are new to the concept, perhaps practitioners of more mainstream methods, the most common criticism is that it is permissive. But in fact, boundaries, limits, and discipline play a crucial role in gentle parenting. If you do not discipline your child, how can you be truly respectful of them? Part of this misconception lies in the general understanding of what it means to discipline a child. Did you know that the word discipline stems from the word disciple, defined in the dictionary as a follower of the doctrines of a teacher or a school of thought? It is from the Latin discipulus, pupil, and dicere, to learn. So discipline implies that there are two active roles, the adult as a teacher and the child as learner, and both should play an equal part in the process. Children learn best by imitating us, learning at their own developmental pace in a place of safety and security, and in a space where their natural desire to make sense of the world is not only respected, but fostered. Yet if you take a straw poll among a group of people as to what discipline means to them, the chances are you will be met with a list that includes, "I got the cane. My parents smacked me if I was out of line. Send the child to the naughty step. If he's naughty, he goes to time out. I was sent to my room with no dinner if I was rude." In my opinion, none of these is an effective form of discipline. They all rely on inflicting physical or emotional pain through shame and exclusion. How does a child learn if they are not shown what to do, if they have nothing and nobody appropriate to model themselves on, or if they do not understand what they did wrong and what they should have done instead? True discipline in society is rare. Most children today are punished. They are punished for being a child, for not acting like an adult, for being too inquisitive and eager to learn, and for not having a well-developed centre of self-control. Misbehaviour is usually a cry for help, a signal that all is not well in the child's world. But most of the behaviour control methods used today penalise the child for having a problem rather than trying to help them solve it. The dictionary definition of punishment is causing or characterised by harsh or injurious treatment, severe, brutal. When children are punished, no real learning takes place. The role of the child is passive. The goal of the adult is control and conformity. And while the vocalisation or physical manifestations of the child's problems may disappear, the issues remain, ready to rise another day, like a festering wound covered with a fresh bandage. Why not help children to solve their problems? Surely then we are better teachers. Authoritarian, authoritative, and permissive parenting approaches. In 1966, psychologist Diana Balmrind identified her parenting typology, a description of three distinct parenting styles: authoritarian, authoritative, and permissive. These can be briefly summarised as follows. Authoritarian is highly demanding. Parents expect behaviour that is perhaps not age-appropriate, has strict boundaries and limits, often in excess, and boundaries and limits enforced using punishments. Child is given very little autonomy. Little regard is given to the age-appropriateness of the punishment. It is very parent-centred approach. The adult knows best. Parents not concerned with their own behaviour and often not good role models. Low levels of affection, and low levels of responsivity. And finally, little respect for the child, but demands a lot of respect for the parent. Authoritative. Parents are demanding of the child, but their expectations are age appropriate. Parents set realistic boundaries and limits. Boundaries and limits are always enforced respectfully. The child is given some freedom and age-appropriate autonomy. Age-appropriate discipline is key. It's a largely child-centred approach. The child is respected as well as the parents. Parents understand the effects of their own emotions. Parents show a great amount of affection and have a good connection to the child. Parents are highly responsive to the child's needs. Permissive. Parents demand little of the child and have very low expectations of their behaviour. The child is often capable of better behaviour, but this is not encouraged. There are few or no boundaries or limits. Any boundaries that do exist are not enforced. The child is often given too much freedom or allowed to do whatever they like. Unwanted behaviour is not disciplined and is often explained away. The child is in control. Parents have little control. Parents may struggle with their own emotions, but they are highly affectionate parents. And finally, parents are highly responsive to the child's needs, but can misinterpret them. So, what is the ideal parenting style? It is one where parents walk a carefully balanced line of good responsiveness and making appropriate demands of their child, ever mindful of their development. The definition of this? Authoritative parenting, or, as I like to call it, gentle parenting. Chapter 1. Sailing the Seven Seas. You can't stop the waves, but you can learn to surf. Jon Kabat-Zinn, Professor of Medicine and Mindfulness Expert. Parenting is like a journey of discovery. As you watch your child exploring the world, you grow as an adult in many ways too. And, as with all the best journeys, you can have a great travelling companion, your child. As you navigate new and undiscovered lands together, there are unexpected twists and turns, hurdles to jump, and obstacles to avoid. Just as the great explorers sailed the seven seas, parents must find their way around parenting and childhood, learning as much about themselves as they do about their children. This is where my own seven C's come in, the seven C's of gentle parenting. These are 7 points, and points they are, not rules, to enable any parent, whatever their background or parenting history, to steer a course throughout the world of parenting as calmly and confidently as possible, while keeping an eye on their final destination, the creation of a happy, confident and secure individual. The seven C's are connection, communication, control, containment, champion, confidence, and consistency. The seven C's are appropriate at any age, whether you have a baby, a toddler, a 5-year-old, 10-year-old, or a teen. For the purposes of this audiobook, however, we will be focusing on their application from birth to 7 years of age. Chapters 3-7 deal with specific age brackets, examining particular aspects of the journey at each stage and how the seven C's can be applied to areas of difficulty commonly experienced by parents. But first, let's look at each of the seven C's in more detail. Connection. Connection, or rather a lack of it, is often at the root of many behaviour issues in children of any age. Whether it's a 9-month-old baby experiencing separation anxiety and waking many times at night, a toddler starting daycare for the first time and crying inconsolably at every drop-off, a preschooler regressing in their toileting behaviour following the arrival of a new baby, or a 6-year-old competing with siblings for the attention of busy parents. All of these situations can be dramatically improved by noting the child's need for connection and responding with the thing they need the most: more of you. Connection is important both in the moment and in the long term. In the short term, a child may misbehave in order to seek reconnection with the parent. For instance, a toddler may tantrum in response to not receiving enough attention from a parent who is involved in a long conversation with a friend or is talking on their phone. In this case, the parent recognising the child's need is key to resolving the behaviour. In the long term, a chronic lack of connection can lead to more serious behaviour issues. This is often the case with slightly older children who spend increasingly more time away from their parents, especially when siblings are involved, and particularly if the parent uses exclusion methods of punishment, such as time out. If the child's need for connection is met with a further undoing of the bond between them and their parent, the problem is likely to be compounded, not resolved. So, it is vital for parents to spend time reconnecting with their children on a regular, preferably daily, basis. What might this look like? A 15-minute chat while putting a child to bed every night is a great start, or 10 minutes of playing together in the evening when everybody is home, topping up at the weekend with some one-to-one time, an hour in the park, baking a cake together, or sharing a book while snuggled on the sofa. It needn't be anything complicated or expensive. All too often, we will take our children to clubs and classes to aid their development, when ironically what they need most of all is downtime with us. It is also important to recognise the need to reconnect with your child during a period of unwanted behaviour. Crying babies, toddler tantrums, preschool whining, and sulks from older children can leave parents understandably frazzled. But when we are exhausted at the end of our tether and wondering why we ever had children in the first place, then that is precisely the time when it is crucial to reconnect. It will not only help to reduce unwanted behaviour in the short term, but will also help your child to feel that you and they are part of the same team, leading to less likelihood of it happening in the longer term. Children should always feel loved by you, no matter what they do. You may not like their behaviour, but you love them unconditionally. And however angry and exhausted you may feel, it is essential that they know this, especially at a time when your reactions may show otherwise. This doesn't mean trying to hug your child during a tantrum, however. It means staying calm and patient while disciplining them, and then reconnecting afterwards when everybody is calmer. Communication. All behaviour is communication. Crying, whining, throwing, hitting, biting, sulking, clinginess, and more. The key is to translate what the behaviour is saying. Your child may have a physical need such as hunger, thirst, tiredness, discomfort, or pain. These are usually the easiest reasons to spot, and usually ones that most parents consider first. But what if their behaviour has a more emotional cause? Are they overstimulated or overwhelmed by a new situation? Or conversely, perhaps they are understimulated and bored? Or is another child invading their personal space and making them feel threatened? Or perhaps they are feeling scared or lonely? The more vocal children become, the easier it is to work with their emotional needs, But even an eloquent 7-year-old can have trouble putting the way they feel into words, and they may express their discomfort via their behaviour instead. On a related note, think carefully about your own communication. Communication is not just verbal. What are your actions and body language telling your child? What might you be conveying if you are deep in conversation with a friend and keep shushing your child's attempt to tell you something important? What might you be demonstrating to your child if you snap and yell at them when they fight with their sibling? Communication is about listening as well as talking. Showing children that we hear them and value what they say is vital to their confidence and self-esteem. The old authoritarian phrase, "do as I say, not as I do," is a great example of what we are often communicating. And children are great imitators. What we do, they will do. The way you behave, therefore, communicates to your child how they should behave. If you struggle with shouty children, the chances are that you may be shouting too much yourself. So consider carefully your body language and behaviour as well as your words. It is also very important to remember that children are not the same as adults when it comes to their understanding of language. Their grasp of instructions, for instance, is far more basic than ours. So telling a child to stop running does not explain what you want them to do instead. Should they hop, jump, stand still? Of course, as adults, we know that what we really mean when we say this is stop running and walk slowly instead. But we haven't communicated that to the child. Telling them to walk, please, would be much better. Communicating effectively with a child can be likened to a doctor with a good bedside manner. Getting down to the child's level in terms of both in words and height, talking eye to eye, and perhaps connecting physically in a gentle manner through hand contact is far less threatening and more positive than if you are towering above them. Think about how you like to be communicated with and emulate that in your communication with your children. Control. Babies and young children have little or no control over their day-to-day lives. What do they really get to choose for themselves? When they go to bed? What they eat? When they eat? How they spend their time? In most cases, control is in the hands of the parent, and much unwanted behaviour is therefore the child's desperate attempt to regain some of that control and assert their autonomy. Toileting, eating and sleeping behaviours are most commonly linked to a control problem. And allowing the child to have as much control as possible, age appropriateness and safety permitting, can dramatically change their behaviour. This needs to go hand in hand with boundaries and limits. Giving a child more control does not mean permissive parenting. Children raised with few or no boundaries or related discipline can feel very insecure. And while it is their job to test these limits, it is ours to set and enforce them. Children need to know what is expected of them, and boundaries are a great way for them to learn. Deciding on the appropriate boundaries for your family is an important part of parenting, and enforcing them calmly and compassionately is crucial. Containment. Babies and young children are not neurologically capable of regulating their emotions. This is not a fault or a problem, it is simple biology. As adults, the mature emotion regulation centre of our brain tells us it is not socially acceptable to scream loudly in a packed cinema when we are scared. When we are frustrated, our brain tells us that it is not the done thing to shout and swear in the middle of the supermarket. And when we are angry, our brains tell us that it is not appropriate to hit or bite the person who is annoying us. Unfortunately, children under 7 do not have these resources. They do not have the ability to use self-talk to calm themselves down. They are like a boiling pot with no lid. Everything explodes unchecked. And when you think about how many things upset them in their daily lives, largely related to their need for connection and control, compounded by their relatively poor verbal communication skills, it is no wonder that their pots so readily boil over. So, babies and young children need a mature adult to act as a container for their big emotions. And that is what they are, not naughtiness, which implies that they have control over their actions. This allows the child the space to release those emotions safely. They need an adult to say, "It's okay. I'm big enough for the both of us. I can help you to diffuse your emotions." A parent's role here is to act as an external regulator for the young child until they are old enough to readjust their own emotions, which can take much longer than society thinks. Of course, as parents, our own containers can get full too, and sometimes we also explode and overflow. This is a sign that it is time for us to empty some of our own emotional load. Finding a listening ear, a hobby, or a way to relax that allows you to create this space to hold your child's feelings is critical. We will talk about this in much more detail in Chapter 2. Champion. Do you have somebody who believes in you, who stands up for you, and who looks out for your interests? Maybe your partner, a friend, or a relative. Think about the last time somebody helped you out, or when somebody really got what you were about and defended you when others didn't. Every child needs a champion too, and their first champion should be their parent. Even before they were born, you have begun to champion for your baby, making informed choices about the delivery and the environment in which your son or daughter would enter the world. And throughout babyhood, many tough decisions are made with the baby's best interests at heart. Each one of these involves you championing your child. Through toddlerhood, into the school years and beyond, your child needs to know that you are on their side, that they needn't be afraid to come to you and tell you their version of the story, that you will listen to them and that even if you are angered by their behaviour, you will be there for them, working with them to resolve the situation. As children grow older, their need for a champion grows stronger. When they venture into the territory of friendship issues and struggles with teachers, the need to know that there is at least one person they can rely on is huge. When everyone else gives up on them, the knowledge that you still believe in them is invaluable. Your unwavering support can give them confidence and courage to face the world when what they may want to do is run and hide. Of course, being your child's champion can be hard, particularly when they are not acting in a way that makes you feel proud. But these are the very moments when they need you the most. When you are called into preschool to discuss a biting incident, the time when they are rude to their teacher at age 5, or when they refuse to do their homework at the age of 7, these are the times when you need to look deeper into their behaviour and champion their cause. Confidence. Gentle parents have confidence in their child and also in themselves. Being confident in ourselves and particularly our own decisions helps us to parent in a much more calm and considered way. This might mean that we need to remove ourselves from situations that test us and distance ourselves from people who make us doubt ourselves. When we are truly confident in our choices, we can also avoid the nagging doubt of guilt and make better decisions. Confidence is about being in connection with our hearts and minds, as well as our children. It can also mean making peace with the way that we ourselves were raised, particularly if it differs from the way we hope to raise our children. Confidence comes from making well-informed decisions and from being surrounded by like-minded people. Parents who feel the same way as you and raise their children in a similar manner. It comes from building a village of support around yourself and your family. Confidence comes with time and experience, from living in the moment, being mindful of your child's stage of development, and taking care of yourself as well. It comes not from following a prescribed way of parenting, but from feeling empowered to make your own decisions. We'll talk about all of these things throughout this audiobook. Having confidence in your child is as important as being confident in yourself. In many ways, we expect too much of babies and young children, but conversely, we overparent them and do not give them adequate space to explore and develop. Picking up a toy that a baby has spent the last 10 minutes trying to pick up themselves, finishing a jigsaw puzzle that a toddler is struggling with, telling a 5-year-old the word they are struggling to read in a book, or immediately stepping in to resolve an argument between 2 7-year-olds. These are all instances of underestimating a child's abilities and not giving them a chance to achieve something themselves. Learning to sit with a child through their struggles without interfering is difficult for some, but showing them that you believe that they can do something and trusting them to do it is so important. Consistency. Many parents implement 6 of the C's well for a few weeks, but the busyness of everyday life or a lack of instant results can cause them to lose heart. Transitioning to parenting gently is not easy, and the effects can often be seen only infuriatingly slowly. We live in a quick fix world where we are used to instant gratification and fast turnarounds. But gentle parenting can take anything from a month to years to really make a difference. That's why taking a long-term view is vital, so as not to lose heart and begin second-guessing your parenting. It is essential to decide on your boundaries and limits and reinforce them every single time and to stick to your beliefs, no matter how busy or tired you are. Far too many parents send mixed messages to their children, allowing them to do something one day and not the next. While it may be tempting to take the easy way out and permit something just this once, think about how confusing this might be for your child. Likewise, keeping your own feelings in check and nurturing yourself are not one-off events. They have to be done on a daily basis. Put simply, the more consistent you are in your parenting, the better the results will be. The 7 C's will provide a framework for you to solve any issues you may have in a gentle way. In chapters 3 to 7, we will revisit them and talk about their practical application at specific stages in your child's development. Chapter 2. It starts with you, becoming a gentle parent. Faith is taking the first step, even when you can't see the whole staircase. Martin Luther King Jr., civil rights activist. Gentle parenting is a belief system, rather than a series of prescribed responses or, when your child does this, you should do this, instructions to follow. At its heart, gentle parenting is about you. It's about who you are, your view towards children's worth, and their right to receive respect from adults. It's about understanding your own childhood and the unfair treatment and lack of emotional support you sometimes faced in it, so you can parent your own children consciously or gently. When you try to be a gentler parent, you must understand that it isn't about quick fixes or scripted advice to follow. Why? Because we parent with decades of conditioning and inherited behaviours and beliefs. You're not only trying to change your own conscious behaviour, but the unconscious behaviour you have inherited from your ancestors too. We all have our own triggers. We all have conditioned and subconscious behaviour that escapes, however much we try to stop it. We must understand and accept this if we want to improve our parenting. We're not going to change overnight. We are still going to get triggered and slip up again and again. The path to becoming a gentle parent is hard work and lifelong. The first step towards change, change that will not only be for you, but hopefully for future generations too, how exciting is that, is to acknowledge these embedded ancestral beliefs and behaviours. To recognise your triggers and to understand where they came from. For instance, if you see red when your child answers back, understand that what you're really reacting to is the way you yourself were treated as a child, and in turn the way your parents and grandparents were treated when they tried to have a voice. When our children behave in ways we were chastised or punished for, it sets off a deep-seated reaction in us that is about so much more than the present moment. Awareness of this triggering is the key for change. The second step is to accept and forgive those who came before you. Understand they were exposed to the same conditioning too. Try to empathise with them and drop any resentment. You can't move forward if you don't. The last step is to mindfully make a change. Recognise those triggered feelings.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.